I've been committed to this. This is part of a series of events run jointly by the Delhi Policy Group, whose Director General is sitting here, Radha, and the Indian Habitat Center. And we are very happy that the head of the Habitat Center is also here. It's supposed to be a neighborhood lecture series, but we have interpreted our neighborhood a little widely. And it's perfectly understandable that the sensible country will interpret its neighborhood as that which affects it, and frankly, in the case of climate change, it's the whole world, whose policies affect us. So it makes sense to think of the world itself as the relevant neighborhood for this purpose. As I'm sure all of you know, the focus now is on the Paris meeting, which is coming up at the beginning of December, and much of the discussion now is in what we can expect from Paris.
Thank you very much, Mr. Desai. Thank you to IAC and to Delhi Policy Group. Very much looking forward to the discussion. Yes, we'll try and keep all the presentations, I think, quite crisp. What I'm going to try and do is set the stage a little bit for the Paris discussions. And I'm going to try and do two things, really, in this talk. One, give a little bit of a sense, as the first speaker, of climate politics in a nutshell, using this device that I call the climate trilemma, and then talk about SDS countries, typically, have a third goal here on the bottom right.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you, Mr. Desai, and thank you to India Habitat Center and the Policy Group for inviting me and us. I'm looking more forward to the conversation that follows the presentations. I think Navroz has set the stage and outlined kind of a very effective kind of principles for what India's strategy could be. What I wanted to do in my presentation was talk a little bit about, in the context of what we need to do, is the world doing enough? And that's what I call climate action versus inaction. And then to reflect a little bit of what that means in contrast with what India has promised to do already. And this kind of goes to Navroz's third strategic point. And whether we are articulating that sufficiently strongly is the question for eating out space. So the INDCs are a positive set. In some ways, it gets everyone to put something on the table.
Good evening to you all. Thank you for braving the pre-Diwali traffic and being here this evening. And thank you to Mr. Desai and the Delhi Policy Group for inviting me to be part of what is already proving to be a fascinating conversation. What I'd like to do in the next 10 minutes is take you through some of the key issues in the 2015 climate negotiations. What I will start by doing is explaining what the central underlying theme is in these negotiations. And that relates to a fundamental paradigm shift that is underway in the climate change regime, in relation to the architecture of the climate regime, in relation to the legal character of mitigation obligations in the climate regime, and in relation to differentiation. And then take you through a couple of the real politics sort of elements for Paris, what challenges we're going to face and what prospects there are for a deal in Paris. So what is the central issue? There is, as I said, a fundamental paradigm shift that's occurring in the climate negotiations, and that has been occurring and has been in process for the last few years. In relation to architecture, what we're finding is that the kind of architecture, the template we found in the framework of mentioned climate change and the Kyoto Protocol is changing. We're now looking at a very different kind of architecture. Why is it changing? How is it changing? We had in the Kyoto Protocol a top-down architecture, a very prescriptive architecture, where countries, developed countries, were given targets, mitigation targets, and asked to fulfill them, set to timetables. There was a compliance system. This compliance system contained an enforcement branch. There were penalties for non-compliance. And in fact, this sort of compliance system is pretty unusual in international environmental agreements. But that's the extent to which we went in terms of a top-down prescriptive architecture backed by a compliance system. What we're finding emerging now in this negotiation, in particular since Warsaw 2013, which started the move towards nationally determined contributions, is that we have a much more bottom-up approach, which privileges autonomy.
What does it do in terms of the scientific foundations for something that works, in terms of adequacy of trying to meet a global narrative, when basically individual countries are all trying to maximize what works best for them? does it add up to something that one would logically expect to be a social welfare objective being attained? And actually, there is no rationale or theoretical justification for at all expecting this. It is well known that when individuals maximize their own utilities from their own perspectives, it may not add up to a socially desirable outcome. So either we consider this, therefore I would say one way of looking at it is to say that if indeed, as per the assessments that are now coming out, both from the IEA and hopefully from the UNFCCC also itself doing its own summarizing, that all these commitments that countries have made voluntarily adds up to a 2.7 degree centigrade limiting warming to 2.7 degree centigrade target, then I would say it's a positive step.